What is the good news in a nutshell? Set down your attempts to disempower yourself and the empowerment that you already are, that you are, that is there. It's here. That's it. Just set down the disempowerment. That's all that has to be done. This is the spiritual path. This is religion. This is salvation. This is truth. Just set down, gently set down your attempt to disempower what you are. That's all we have to do. Very simple. Now, in this world right now, there is sort of a global corporate ideology which is aimed at disempowerment. Continue to try and empower disempowerment. I would say that's the global religion right now, to empower disempowerment. All we have to do is just set that down. Now, when we set that down, we're going to experience more of what we are, okay? Which is empowered, truly empowered. So our experiencing is going to be way, way better as we move forward here. Going towards 2:15, there will be a parting of the ways, the way I see it going right now. Because the attempt to empower disempowerment is really ramping up right now. Intensely ramping up. And I've been getting many, many, many subtle indications that this is the time. This is the time where there really seems to be a parting of the destiny paths between those who want to empower disempowerment and those who are willing to set disempowerment down, the attempt at disempowerment. Just set it down, that's all. It's like we're holding up a mask, you know, to the world. All we have to do is just set the mask down, and our original face is there. That's all. We don't have to fix anything, change anything, do anything. Just set it down. Just gently set it down. So, just last couple days, I've just been subtly noticing what's there to notice, and just saying, "Wow, I see that. I see that. I see that." And it certainly is pointing towards very much a parting of the destiny paths. That we, those who want to set disempowerment down, the notion, false notion of disempowerment, the attempt at disempowerment, set it down. At least to a large extent, or at least go in that direction. That's their ideology. Their ideology is, our ideology is, set down the attempt at disempowerment. Set it down. Now, we may not just do it right this moment, but we're getting closer and closer to setting it down. That those who want to do that, it's time to do it, because the global attempt to empower disempowerment is getting very, very, very strong and strident, and it's about time when the whole thing is going to, it is being pushed too far, right now, even today. And this has been an ongoing situation, continuously building, like the storm that's building up off the coast of California right now. It is supposed to be a deluge tomorrow. Some places expecting 10 inches of rain in an 8 to 10 hour period almost. It's just, it's supposed to just absolutely come down with ferocious winds. We haven't seen a storm like this in a long time here. It's been gentle weather here for so long. Nothing like this. And so we've been waiting. They're telling us, you know, get in the lifeboats. And still, it's still kind of calm and mild, and doesn't seem to be any problem. But it's just right off the coast. It's actually sweeping into Northern California, far northern parts of California, North Bay Area right now. And they're starting to get hammered. And so here we're you know, where we are is nothing yet, but we do know it will sweep through here. It's going to sweep through here tomorrow. We know that. Just like that, we know that there's been this tremendous storm buildup in the world, very much engineered by this cosmic corporation that is at play here on a global scale, and it's going to soon sweep through this world in a deluge. Ideological. People will feel like to the ideology of disempowerment, they'll think that that's salvation. They'll think, wow, I finally got it. You know, yeah, guilt, sin, disempowerment. I got it. And the world will feel that way. Like, it'd be like they got religion. They think they got religion. It's like, wow, I finally realized, they say, that I'm a terrible person. I deserve to die. I shouldn't be so empowered. I need to, you know, feel guilty. I need to, and it'll be this sort of collective insanity, stupidity, as a religion. It's actually, much of the planet already thinks that way, believes that way, but the finishing touches are coming soon. So it'll be a global hegemony of everybody feeling like they finally got it. So this is not a benevolent situation for those who are going to set disempowerment down. I was shown quite some time ago in a very strong, vivid dream, a very frightening dream, showing me some events that were going to take place. It must have been more than 10 years ago. And I have not been able to figure them out up until now. Just yesterday, I just started saying, uh-oh, it looks like this is being fulfilled. It must have been shown something that's going to happen in the future. And now it's being fulfilled. The events that are taking place in the world right now, particularly, point out the United States, the kind of social pressures people are being put under. They're being pressured to what? Join the disempowerment movement. Join the disempowerment movement. This is what everybody's being pressured. And the pressure now is just getting ferocious. Ferocious. And at some point, again, there'll just sort of be this collapse into this feeling that disempowerment, and that, and then think, this is it. We finally got it, because it'll seem like a change. It'll seem like people are all agreeing now, like, yeah, we need it. We need disempowerment as the way. And for a little while, I feel like when everyone feels they're on the same page, there's a feeling like of optimism, like, hey, we're about to finally succeed in some way. we'll finally succeed in collapsing into disempowerment. Apparent disempowerment. Not real, of course. So this is on the way. This is on the way. And what's amazing is I'm getting all these subtle indications that it is going to be very soon. Very, very soon. And as far as the progress that I'm making, it's very rapid, very deep, and I'm just sort of just not saying much about it, just noticing it. So it really does seem that we've reached a point now, a breaking point in the world. And it may be that the next 18 months are a matter of just gathering in, the ingathering of those who have decided to set down disempowerment, whereas the rest of the world just goes all in on trying to empower disempowerment. So they're already, you know, basically all in anyway. Education is all in on empowering disempowerment. The whole society, just looking at it, it's for me, it's so easy to see. Wow, it's just amazing what the focus is in this world. Just amazing. It's like they're absolutely oblivious to what their focus could be. Absolutely oblivious to it. I don't believe that the great teachers are just going to sit by and let their devotees be sucked into this oblivion. I don't believe that's going to happen. I'm becoming more and more and more aware of how I was pulled down by this cosmic corporate agenda of empowering disempowerment, and how I tried to make adjustments and overcompensated and got all, lost my balance here. And it just becoming more and more and more aware of this now. It's like an awakening, actually, is taking place. So I'd say there is an awakening taking place. And I'm just calmly just noticing it. We think things are fine, but for instance, there's this little beetle in the western and eastern parts of the country, that borer beetle. It bores into black walnut trees and bores a little hole and gets past the bark into the tree, into its circulation, I guess. And the problem is that these borer beetles have a fungus on them. Somehow little, microscopic fungi are hitched a ride on these beetles, and then the fungus get into the interior of the tree and then start multiplying and spreading throughout the interior of the tree, and it kills the black walnut trees where we get, our wood, walnut wood, around the whole world. And Missouri is where is the heart of black walnut forests and cultivation, huge part of their economy. And the beetle hasn't reached there yet, the borer beetle, but they say it's on its way and it could arrive any day. Who knows what could bring it in, right? With all humans moving about, a lot of stuff moving about. Once it gets going, it could easily decimate its entire industry, and in a short period of time, all the trees will be dead. So here we are, we're thinking, what could go wrong? What could go wrong, really? Well, there's a lot of borer beetles in the world, actually, carrying a lot of fungus. In a larger way of looking at it, and getting into the world, and this fungus spreading, and for it collapse. This is the way of what we call nature, but it's the way of disempowerment, actually, which we have crafted. We have crafted this. Now, I just bought some black walnuts today. Some nuts from black walnut trees. Actually, there are two types of black walnut trees, the one for timber and the one for nuts. And I always used to wonder, where does all this walnut wood come from? People put floors in a walnut, a trim. It's beautiful, beautiful wood. But I look at the walnut trees here and I say, how could they get these long planks, these beautiful planks of wood? It's amazing. Well, the black walnut tree for timber goes like straight, really, really straight, big, straight, 80 feet up in the air, so you get these big, beautiful lumber out of it. And the ones that the nuts grow on are small, much, much smaller, and branch out a lot. Anyway, I tasted black walnuts for the first time today. I said, they're okay, but they're better in baking. They're used in baking, mostly. Understandable. I think they would do very well in baking. Not so good just eating them straight. They're okay. I prefer the other type of walnuts. So here's this industry that is in peril, even though everything seems fine right now, right? Everything seems fine, but there's this bug, this beetle that once it reaches Missouri, is going to theoretically wipe out the entire industry, kill all the black walnut trees. So here we are in this world, believing that everything seems okay. Not necessarily. not necessarily. If you're aware of some of the trends, borer beetle trends, the social borer beetle trends, and how these beetles are boring into the ideology and beliefs and culture, and bringing with them a lot of this fungus that rots it out and you know, brings it down, then you'll realize we're not in very good shape. And we need to be saints. We're either going to be corporate sinners or spiritual saints. If you go in the path of trying to empower disempowerment, you're going to be a corporate sinner, so to speak. You're going to be a sheeple. And if you go on the path of setting down this stupid idea of disempowerment, you're going to be a saint, no question. How can you be a saint? Well, again, we're all perfect. We're all perfect saints. But those who are trying to empower disempowerment are unaware of this, and doesn't seem that they are, because they're trying to not be that way. Whereas those who give up this effort, setting it down, naturally they say, oh, this is what I am. Okay, I've always been this way. So sinners and saints is the difference, sinners and saints. And it's possible just to shift into this saintly perspective. Absolutely. In fact, we have to do that. This is what happens when we set down this disempowerment, this attempt to disempower ourselves, which is utterly all-pervasive. You might call it like an ocean. And we're like fish swimming in this ocean. It's that pervasive here. But we can set it down. When we set it down, we're going to automatically enter into the saintly disposition, automatically. But doesn't seem to be happening on any sort of scale at this point. But who knows what's going to happen? Maybe many will do this. I don't know. Because it's hard to tell. Hard to tell just where exactly we are, where anyone is as far as doing this. It's difficult to tell. Because it's very subtle, just what everything I'm noticing now, just saying, I can tell that I seem to be awakening in this direction very strongly. But for all intents and purposes to the world, I'm just same old, same old, same old. Subtle shift. It's very possible. And then basically this saintly disposition is just there, because you set down, your attention is no longer on trying to deny this. Attention is no longer on trying to deny this. And what we're told is that the world will then look very different to us. It'll seem very friendly, inviting, like the whole world is there to support us. That's what we're told, how it feels, because we've given up the attempt to use the world to disempower ourselves. Right now, in this attempt to empower disempowerment, the world, the way the world is, it seems to be, you know, really trying to do us in many ways. Whereas when we drop the attempt to disempower what we are, then the world seems like an extremely benign, wonderful, friendly place. There's nothing that is against you at all. Nothing is against you. This is the shift into the saintly disposition, where nothing is against you. It doesn't feel like anything's against you. Everything is for you. And this is what I've been noticing to date. Like, everything that's happening, it seems to be helping me, and it seems to be for me. People are saying stuff to me, and situations are arising now where I just like, as they say, huh. And then somehow it points something out to me very strongly, and I recognize something. So it's like everyone's like acting like a guru to me right now. Very interesting. I'm getting these difficult assignments, and then suddenly, last second, they're changed. I say, no, you don't have to do that. I don't panic. I get this difficult assignment and just say, okay. Alright, I'll see if I can do that in my work, and then I get a change. It says, no, you know what? It's being taken care of. You don't have to do that. Here's something else that's easier. Oh, okay, great. Now, this is happening a lot right now. Now this sort of symbolizes, and suddenly I get a change call and say, no, you don't have to deal with that. You don't have to deal with that at all. It's a nice, benign situation. Oh, okay, great. And people are smiling at me more. And so there's something going on for sure. You see this cosmic corporate cabal, which is operating here, which is really just our attempt to disempower what we are, so that we can prove we have a greater will than God by disempowering what God created, which is really disempowering the will of God, changing the will of God. This cosmic corporate cabal that's operating here doesn't want any saints at all. Doesn't want the saintly disposition here at all. Doesn't even want even one. Not even one. Not even one saint on this planet. That's their goal. So indeed, it seems like difficult to get through that, but we'll see what happens. Certainly, there are very, very, very powerful trends at work right now in the world towards disempowerment, towards trying to empower disempowerment, trying to empower disempowerment. That is the trends. These are the trends. And if you don't want to be just very, very stupid and fall into this like almost like a coma, you're going to have to say no to that and say no. So I've been finding the words and the ideas coming more and more, flowing more and more, of being able to say no to it. But I haven't been able to do it outwardly in the world. It's more inwardly. I'm saying no to it inwardly. But not the words to the world so much yet. But I'm seeing there's a different way to deal with situations. No question about it. So something is... some powerful, powerful, positive antidote is at work. And again, I wouldn't be surprised at all if between now and Christmas, now and New Year's, there's something really does shift it's time. It is absolutely time now. There's no question about it. So I'm just remaining patient. Not trying to force it, but the currents are there. They really are there. Remember that this world believes that disempowerment is empowerment, because if they don't disempower what they are, they feel they will be, God will disempower them. But either way you slice it, it's like saying, well, either we disempower ourselves or God disempowers us. Either way, the goal is still disempowerment. How can that be what we really want? It's crazy, obviously, and yet we decide that one of those is the answer. Now we're going to disempower ourselves and therefore avoid God disempowering us. And I guess we think that somehow that would be better. Of course, we can't disempower ourselves. If we could, there'd be no reality at all. So it's a moot point, which is better or worse. But we want to feel in charge of our destiny as far as how can we disempower ourselves. So in some way, in this world of saints says, there is no disempowerment. I'm not disempowered at all. They say, oh, that's terrible. God is going to disempower you then and disempower us because we're associating with you. You know, they get very frightened. They say, we'll force disempowerment upon you. You're frightening us. So, unfortunately, this is still the disposition of this world. And just going around a lot, as I am now, I can just see the oblivion in everyone. Just looking to see, is anyone? It's just oblivious. Oblivious, so that's why I really can't talk. It's difficult to talk about it at all. When you talk about it to someone, when you talk about it to anyone who's just oblivious to what you're pointing at, it's just a waste of time. They're not aware of the great teachers, the great teaching, path to salvation, you know, all this familiarity. They're simply not aware of it. They're oblivious to it, completely oblivious. If you said, well, I'm a saint, they wouldn't have a clue what you're talking about. They think, oh, great, you're here to, like, make my life, mow my grass or make my life happier. Then you're just a servant, my servant. Oh, servant of truth, actually, here. But not a servant of trying to empower disempowerment, which is what people of the world are trying to do. Trying to empower disempowerment. They want to have a powerful push towards disempowerment. Powerful collapse. And if you just say, well, there is no disempowerment, I don't have any. You know, I say, well, how does that help us? Well, it helps by pointing out the truth. I still don't know what is going to happen, but definitely feels that there is going to be some strategy taking place. The game is very much front and center in the world right now. These two different directions are becoming very clear, very clearly differentiated, very clearly differentiated now is what's happening. So that may be part of awakening, as you begin to see extremely clear differentiation. And you just say, wow, this is what the world's trying to do. Wow, so it's not all fuzzy and you can't tell the difference. You see the difference, very clear difference. So that's what's happening to me right now. I'm seeing the difference between how those who engage in trying to empower disempowerment, what that life is all about, which is the life of the world. That is the life of this world. That's all that it is. And then the spiritual path, how different that is, by working to get familiar enough with setting down the effort to empower disempowerment. Being very familiar with that, that's the spiritual path. And most people in the world are oblivious to this spiritual path. And they feel like they could not even, in their wildest imagination, conjure up any such situation like that. And so it's pretty tough. You feel like you don't exist. If this is, you know, the spiritual path that your existence here in this world, you feel like you don't exist. A little bit of wind stirring things up. Starting to increase a little bit. They say this storm is going to be characterized by tremendous, fierce, fierce winds. Like average wind velocity during the rain is like 30 miles an hour. That's pretty strong wind. Gusts up to 50 in urban areas, up to 50. So 30 and gusts up to 50. In the hills, gusting up to 80 miles an hour. If some places could be even, who knows, might even be higher. If some places speed up the wind. But that's you know, nearing, I don't know what hurricanes are, but 100 miles an hour is pretty strong. 80 with heavy, heavy rain is strong stuff. So we're going to get pelted. Much like the world is about to get pelted, and it has been getting pelted recently in certain areas, right? Oh, Holy Spirit has just had me pay attention to certain things and just noticing, and just notice this. I see it's all lining up as a push. I say, oh, absolutely, I see that. Certainly it is. Again, the world's goal is to empower disempowerment, and religion essentially stands in the way of that. In some ways. And certainly focusing on spiritual truth stands in the way of that, because based on reason, based on truth, based on quiet mind, based on discipline, based on self-control, based on putting your attention onto what is truly important, and setting down, and you know, it's based on realization, based on inspiration, based on help from great teachers, great teachings. All of that, it's based on all of that. And this is what the those who want to empower disempowerment, this is what they want to get rid of. It's interfering with their goal. Interferes with their goal is the way they look at it. So they have a false premise. They have a false premise in our not examining that premise at all. See, in order to keep a false premise, you have to not examine it at all. You have to be distracted from it. So this world is a place of extreme distraction from the false premise that is at the root of it. False premise is that God, this is God's handiwork, and our mission is, God gave us a mission to disempower ourselves. That's a false premise. Okay, starting to heat up a little bit here. Yeah, this is just, I guess, just a very tiny bit of what's to come. They tell us down trees, power's going to be out, all this stuff. So when you feel the social storms, you know, in the world, the ideological storms start to heat up like this, right? You better know that some big, big, really big storm is on the way. We've certainly been experiencing that in the United States for a while now. What those who want to empower disempowerment, what do they want? They want your reason. They don't want you. They want your reason to be gone. So they want you to go into emotion instead of reason. They want you to be unable to see any difference between attempt to empower disempowerment, and the willingness to give that up. They want you to be unable to differentiate. They want you to be in this fuzzy, emotional, confused, angry state. And again, this will morph into the idea that this is the new religion of the world. This is the way you're supposed to be a good person, to be on the side of right, to be a righteous person. And people will feel like they want to feel righteous, you know, and they'll finally collapse, go into a collapse condition, and they'll say, oh, maybe now I'll believe that I'm righteous by embracing the attempt to empower disempowerment. By embracing that, they feel by definition maybe they're righteous, but they won't actually feel that way. They just will feel agitated and mistake that for empowerment. The belief, when one tries to empower, disempower, what happens is agitation. One gets very agitated. And they believe that this is a sign of righteousness, you see, that this is, they're succeeding. It's like a blessing. They're blessed with agitation. So you have a whole world going toward agitation, actually. Whereas, if you set down the attempt to empower disempowerment, what you feel is this stillness, this peace, this bliss, opposite of agitation. You feel totally non-agitated. This is what you'd call a saint. And the ones who are extreme agitation is what you might refer to as a sinner, just to use this, the dialectic of saint-sinner. Huge difference. So we're either going right now towards extremely agitated state of mind, or towards bliss, peaceful, still bliss, just a radiant calm, radiant peace, radiant bliss. So one or the other. It's one or the other. Agitation is the fungus. It's the fungus in the body, cultural body. You get these borers, beetles that bore into the body of culture, and they bring with them this fungus, and this fungus is the fungus of agitation. And it spreads throughout the cultural body. It spreads throughout the global consciousness. And get agitation, and it becomes worse and worse. One day the agitation arrives at your doorstep. So don't be surprised. It's surprised if something really significant occurs in this world now. I was told, wait until about 2:15, and that's when something amazing will happen. Yeah, it seems to be right on track. I don't know how far gone everyone is. It seems as though they're very far gone in this world. Everyone's very far gone. But we don't know. Don't really know for sure. It's possible that some will when an amazing situation of this calm, peace and calm, saintliness, it somehow is in the world, they will recognize it and say, oh, that's what I want. And I don't know, it's theoretically possible. But this cosmic corporate cabal, their takeover of this world, has been extremely clever and thorough. And it's, I wonder if, you know, if how many have managed to extricate themselves or are in a position to. That I had a little bit of off time today, and how I used that time was to rake up all the leaves all over, rake up big piles of leaves and debris, and get it safely in bins. So now this wind is when it roars through here, there's not that many leaves. It's not going to be just disaster. But before I had all these big piles of leaves everywhere in the wind. What was that? It was a big bird just was flapping there in the trees. Huh. That was interesting. So all these big piles of leaves, I got them. The wind would blow them everywhere. Just the everything would be just an absolute mess. Absolute mess. So able to get the leaves safely put away just before the storm struck. So it's good that it delayed a little bit, actually. It gave us a chance to, you know, get things shipshape before the storm strikes. So maybe that in the world, that before the storm strikes, culturally in the world, we have a chance to gather in those who are leaving this nonsense behind. And how do we leave it behind? Just set down, exchange belief systems, set down the belief in empowering disempowerment in exchange for just allowing what is to be. So apparently that wind was so strong it dislodged some bird from its perch or something. It was flapping around like it got tossed out of a tree or something. I bet you the birds are looking for a place to, a secure place, right? To ride out the storm. Yeah, just like we're looking for a secure place to ride out this global, this cultural storm of embracing, you know, to empowering, trying to empower disempowerment. It's like the masochist, you know, inflicting torture on themselves, and they feel that they're empowering disempowerment. So they're caught up in this to feel, yeah, I'm empowering myself by, you know, disempowering myself. This is the ideology, sort of. The world's sort of like masochistic. Very much so. But you can see how that one might say, yeah, I'm by hurting myself, I'm the one who's hurting myself, so I'm empowering myself by hurting myself. We do this by trying to become more and more animalistic, abandoning what we call truly human. But really, to be truly human is to be a saint, actually. And we're abandoning that, to almost totally abandoning that. So we're becoming more and more animalistic, less capable of putting our attention on reason, clarity of reason. Not logic or intellect, but reason, clarity of reason, which shows us what we've been trying to do and the folly of what we've been trying to do, the continuity problem, how to gradually gain familiarity, move our comfort zone of familiarity. There's all this beautiful abstract reason that we have, which helps us reconcile and realize that, hey, we cannot disempower ourselves. Reason basically points out very clearly and shows us that we cannot disempower ourselves. It's impossible. This is reason. So when we try to become more animalistic, we become unaware of that. And we become cunning and scheming and manipulative and seductive and tricky and slick and sly and treacherous and all these nasty traits, animalistic traits. We become very terrible when we turn our backs on our attention away from reason, spiritual reason. That's what the Holy Spirit put in us, is spiritual reason. So we go into this world, they tried to keep it, and the people say, well, we don't do that here, not here. No, not this place, that's just not done, not allowed, nobody does that here. I said, well, I should have said, well, unfortunately I was unable to completely just dismiss all that and ignore it. It is possible to ignore it, no question. So we're probably underestimating the agitation that we're headed towards. You see, people, agitators, they claim that no, they're only agitated because the enemy is agitating them. But though the saints are not agitated by anything, all is blissful, all is calm. Whereas the agitators always find those who agitate them. And he says, no, I'm very peaceful and blissful and calm. It's just that there's this terrible enemy that's agitating me so terrible. They're forcing me to feel this way. That's why. That's what they always say. But inside, they're extremely agitated. And yet, they don't think they are. So you can have an entire world of people who are very, very agitated within. But they don't believe they are at all. They say, no, we're peace-loving people. We love peace. But, you know, what your actions are causing us to be extremely agitated and angry. But how could you feel agitated and angry unless you were trying to empower disempowerment? If you gave up the attempt to empower disempowerment, you would simply realize you can't be disempowered at all. So how could you be angry or agitated? If there's nothing anyone can do to disempower you in the slightest bit, how could you feel angry or agitated, fearful, defensive, or someone's trying to attack me or something? There's no attack. I can't be attacked. I can't be disempowered at all, not in even the tiniest way. So how could I be angry and upset? See? Doesn't add up, does it? So, this cosmic corporate cabal operating here now in this world, and they have a very well-defined ideology of how they want you to think and believe and act, and everybody's falling into lockstep with this here. And to fall into lockstep with it is people believe that they're being empowered. It's kind of like Nazi Germany, all the rallies they had and parades and everything, everybody, you know, feel like, hey, we're in lockstep with, and to be in lockstep with everybody else, we feel like, hey, we're really powerful. We're really powerful. But how'd that work out? So people get this notion that to be in lockstep with disempowerment that is somehow very empowering. And that the peace and they'll feel wonderful and totally empowered as soon as they crush all their enemies, the ones that are making them feel agitated. Of course, everybody has a different idea of who's making them agitated, so you head towards chaos. With everybody feeling that somehow they're about ready to grab hold of success and happiness and safety as soon as they complete their attacks. That's a pretty strong wind. Yes, indeed. Let's just pray that all the trees stay upright and thank them for that. Just place everything under the protection of the saints, the ones who are not trying to disempower themselves at all, who are blissful, who are peaceful, who are calm, and nothing can happen. But no disempowerment can happen. Now, so the world used to do that. It used to pray to the saints, and they were moving in the right direction. And now this is, again, the cosmic corporate cabal is oblivious to this, absolutely oblivious. It doesn't show up anywhere on their sophisticated radar, not even as the tiniest blip. They say, well, it doesn't exist. Completely under the radar, doesn't even exist. This is the world, modern world now. So when the teacher says, let there be peace, let there be peace, let there be peace, among all beings, let there be peace, let there be peace, well, peace comes from giving up your attempt to empower disempowerment. So you stop trying to disempower yourself and the world and all there is. Because you're part of the oneness, you are the oneness, there's only one oneness. All is the one oneness. And so you just, once you give that up, you realize nothing can disempower you. So you are at peace. Peace is our natural condition. It's not something to be attained or realized or anything. It's our natural state. Our natural condition is peace. We can't be disempowered at all. So we're peaceful. Nothing could bother us. We're not a body. I'm not a body. I am free. I am still spirit as God created me. I cannot be disturbed. Cannot be bothered or agitated. So I'm going to need to call upon the saints to calm the winds in this area, because we have some trees that I certainly don't want them breaking. And this is just a little taste of it. Like, wow. And now look how calm it is now. So this is a very gusty storm, apparently. Very gusty. And once the rain comes and everything's saturated, everything's heavy with rain, then those very strong gusts, you know, the trees are so heavy with the wind, that's when they have trouble. Fortunately, we have had some rain before this big storm, so that the trees have been able to hydrate to some extent, which makes them more supple. The problem is here you get, like, the eucalyptus trees are when they get very dry, they can, you know, split under heavy wind and rain. they've told us, you're likely to lose your power. You're very likely. Expect it. That's what they're telling everybody. Some of the school districts up in the North Bay closed down. No school Thursday and Friday. A lot of schools are doing that. But we will expect peace here, call upon peace here. Now, you've heard the stories, at least I have, of throughout history of saints being called upon to calm storms and what. Sure, it happens. It can happen, it doesn't always have to happen, but sometimes the collective will is for it to be stormy in order to feel disempowered, and that's what people want. But if they really decide, you know, let's go the way of the saint, of saintliness, let's go that way, then calling upon saints, absolutely can have miraculous effects here, apparently so-called miraculous effects. The storm can be calmed, absolutely it can. The agitation can be calmed. In people, in nature, and always. Because all the agitation is simply our own handiwork, attempt to empower and disempowerment. So we decide to, hey, this is not what we really want. It's easy just then to let it go. And that we'll accept what the saint has to give us, which is peace. And then the agitation seems to vanish. See, right now it's utterly still. So do not be agitated in your mind at this point. If there's some agitation that arises, just be more patient. Just say, have faith in the awakening. Have faith in the awakening. Somehow, we don't try to figure it out how it's going to happen. That's when the agitation starts to arise. It has its own way of coming to fruition. Now, the Pineapple Express has made its way to the coast from the tropics. Very mild here right now. Feels like the tropics. So the key is don't be agitated. Trust that peace is there. All we have to do is set down our attempts to disempower ourselves. Just let them go. Just relax your mind, release your thoughts, and let them go. Relax your mind, release all attempts at disempowerment, and just let it go. And peace will automatically be there. This is the attitude to have. Just let it go. Let it all go. And this is what is dawning for me. Absolutely it is. So we'll see. We'll see.